Please pray with me. May the words of my mouth and the purposes of our hearts be always acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
I want to wish you all a good morning on this day, Sunday after Easter, and remind you again that this Sunday after Easter is called Low Sunday. The reason it's called Low Sunday is because there are very few people in church today. But that's true across the country, except an exception for Divine Redeemer, because they are out on a retreat. Over 100 of them, and that's wonderful. I hear also that 18 of them are from Emmanuel Presbyterian Church. So there's a partnering going on there that I think is very important for both congregations. In fact, churches should partner more, because if you look at the Pew results of investigation, almost every congregation is losing members. I saw that you gained some members, and that's very positive. But in fact, across the country, and even across the world, the church continues to diminish. And so we need to be reminded of that. And so I'm happy to be here. And I do want to, before I begin with the sermon, to thank my mother-in-law for the prayer. When I came here as circling year, I stole one of your daughters. She used to be a liturgist for me. And we would sit up there, and her mother would say, "There's something going on here." So we were married in 1994. So we've been blessed for 25 years. And she could not come today because she is youth leader at St. Andrew Presbyterian Church where we attend. She took time and her own money to go to Princeton Seminary in New Jersey to get a certificate in theology and ministry and youth ministry. So she served. And I guess she's never tired of education. But she and Caleb, our son, who's 15, are at St. Andrew Presbyterian Church. And so I'm glad for that. This morning we are considering the experience of the disciples. I want to go back a little bit to the book of Acts, because the book of Acts is the historical book of the Bible. In the New Testament, it's where where Luke tries to put together all what they had seen and heard, and he begins it by saying, "My dear Theophilus." Theophilus is not a person; it's Greek for a lover of God. So he tries to put down all the things that happened, and in the beginning, as you well know, the disciples were scared. Mary Magdalene and other of the women went to the tomb and found it empty, and they told Peter. And Peter ran and looked and saw that the linens were folded and the tomb was empty, and he took off. He took off, and then they all gathered and were gathered together and were afraid. What were they afraid of? They were uncertain what had happened, first of all. And second, they were afraid of their own Jewish brothers and sisters. We have a very wrong impression about the apostles. Some people say that the disciples that Jesus called were people who had no training, and that is not true. All these Galileans were very well schooled in the Torah, very well schooled in the scriptures of the time. And even though they were not professionals, even though they did not have highly skilled jobs, they were most of them fishermen, yet they were knowledgeable about the promise that God has made and had made about a Messiah. And so we have in this first five chapters are the disciples discovering that the Holy Spirit is what's going to give them the power to be witnesses to Jesus Christ. And once they receive the Spirit, there's a little thing that happens. They all gather together, and they would sell all their goods, and they would share them one with another. And at the time, they weren't known as Christians. They were known as people of the way. No way is people of the way. We have to remember that. But they were convinced and wanted to convince their Jewish friends, the council, that Jesus was the Messiah. The man they had taken and crucified and hung on a tree had died, but had risen. And it was their job now to make disciples of Jesus Christ. So that's the background of the text that we have. But I want to talk a little bit more about that because it's very relevant for us today. This being Low Sunday, I was amazed. I'm very amazed at the fact that Easter Sunday, we see people we haven't seen before. But the most amazing thing is that there are a lot of children. There's no children here today. But there are a lot of children, and you know why the parents bring them? Guess. Easter egg hunt. Think about it. Easter egg hunt. They're all excited about collecting the eggs. They don't bring them for instruction. They don't bring them for training. They don't bring them to learn about what it is to be faithful. And so sometimes we get surprised. My son, who's 15 years old, was a liturgist on Easter Sunday. And he did very well. But we made it very sure that even though he was baptized in this church, by my father, by the way, who was 99, baptized him here, he has been faithfully raised in the faith. And so this is Low Sunday for many reasons, because we forget what our responsibility is. But what happened to the disciples is that while they were speaking about Jesus and teaching and preaching, the members of the council, I imagine it was the Sanhedrin, the leaders of the Jewish faith, came to them and said, "You must stop. You're not continue to do this." And it's when Peter says what? He says, "We must obey God instead of human authority." And he reminds them of why they're doing it. And so there comes a person to defend him, to defend the disciples. His name was Gamaliel. He was a leader in the council. He was a great teacher. He was a scholar. And he said to them, "Look, leave them alone. You remember there were two other people who had a following. One was Thaddeus, and the other one was Judas." Judas, not Judas Iscariot, but another Judas. And he said they had a following. They thought they were somebody. But when they died, the followers fell to the side. So leave them alone. If this is a God thing, then they will remain. And if it's not, they'll also fade away, like the others. Now, we encountered this Gamaliel another time. You recall that he was the teacher of the Apostle Paul. That's why when we look at Christian theology, we look at Romans, we look at the letters of the first and second Corinthians, to Ephesians, and all of those letters that Paul wrote, established and wrote to those churches, Paul was a student of Gamaliel, who was one of the outstanding authorities of Scripture at the time. So all of these things are linked together, because I think God works in so many mysterious ways that sometimes we don't quite understand. But this happened to the disciples, and so they were able to continue instead of being thrown in prison again, like Peter was before him. So what we have here is an interesting microcosm of the time then, and I want to move it over to our present time. Those Galileans were preaching not to the world, or teaching to the world. They were teaching to their own people, to the Jews. They wanted to convince the Jews that Jesus was the promised Messiah, that Jesus was the Christ. And so, they were doing it in their own context. They were trying to be responsible to the world in which they were born. But today, we live in a whole different time. We don't have just one people. We have many different people. We don't have just one religious faith. I know the guy that services our pool is a Muslim. And when I hired him, he came in and I looked at him and I said, "You're Arabic." He said, "No, I'm Egyptian." I said, "But you're a Muslim." He said, "Yes, I am." And so we encountered, they had a conversation, and I have a sign, we have a sign in front of our house that is in Spanish, in English, and in Arabic. And it says, "You are welcome here." And he saw that. And he said, "I appreciate that." I said, "It is true. Even though we do not share the same faith, we share the same ancestry. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob." And so, in our conversation, in our give and take, he gave me a Quran in English. And I thought, this is my opportunity to give him a Bible in English. So we, every time he comes, we have a conversation and we share with one another. And I'm going to defer it a little bit because when I met him, I went to the store and I locked the keys in my car and my wallet. And so I was sitting there outside wondering, what am I going to do? And a little AAA truck comes around. So I asked the man, I said, and he looked like he was an Arab. I said, "Could you open my car?" And he said, "I can't." He said, "I can't because you have to call him first." I said, "Well, my car's in the car." So he went into his truck, he got a little bit of room, and he opened it up. And I said, "How much do I owe you?" And he said, "You don't owe me anything." He said, I am a Muslim, and it's Ramadan, and I'm to do good deeds." Now, here's a person, not of our faith, who felt that it's a responsibility to do good deeds. So I went home, and I told Cynthia, I said, "You know, Allah sent me an angel today." So she went on to Trinity to do her regular running. And while she was there, she called me and said, "I can open the car." I said, "Well, let me go, and you take my car to work and go get dressed. And I'll get the car home, your car home somehow." So while I was waiting there, I saw this little truck go by. Another Arabic who I motioned to, he came over, and I said, "Could you open my car?" And he said, "Well, I'm not supposed to, but it's Ramadan. I need to do something good." So I said, "You know, there's something to this. Even though it's not our faith, their God, Allah, has responded to our need." So we live in a different context. We speak in a different kind of world where there are many different religions. So we cannot take what they were doing and say, "Well, this is what they were doing." But we need to learn what it does, our responsibility in the context in which we live. The other thing too is that we live in a society where it's so easy to forget. We say we're a Christian nation, we're not. 33% of Americans belong to the Christian faith, do you know that? And the growing number of people in our surroundings are called the nuns. They're mostly millennials who are younger and who feel that they don't need an organized religion. They don't need church. You know where their church is? It's at Walmart, at Target, at the soccer fields, wherever they can take their children to enjoy, and it's not in the church. And so it calls our attention to the fact that our circumstances have changed, and yet we're challenged by this particular text about why the apostles were so, it was such an important thing for them. Consider the challenges that we have. The apostles were teaching and preaching to their own people. They were not doing that just because there had been other leaders, but they felt that Jesus Christ was the leader. And their purpose really was a basic purpose for which we need to pay a lot of attention, and that is to make disciples for Jesus Christ. Sometimes, I've been in the ministry a long time. I was ordained in 1961. I served here 1 year long enough to speak, to take a daughter. But I had been a professor at McCormick Theological Seminary and vice president of the school. And so in all that time, I've been convinced of one thing, that it is our responsibility and my responsibility to speak to anyone about our faith. It's not common today. I don't know, one day I was sitting there and a worker came to the house to do some work, and I started talking to him about our faith. And Cynthia said, "You don't miss a lick, do you?" We're not supposed to. We're supposed to take every opportunity. So every person that I meet, I ask them, "Do you go to church? What is your faith? Where do you attend?" Because the majority of people today are not religious. They're very few. And some of us, I think, are so because it is our tradition. I was raised in the Presbyterian Church. My father was a Presbyterian minister. I didn't want to be a minister, but I became one. But it was the influence of the home and the influence of the people who were around who continued, like the apostles, who said, "We must obey God rather than human authority." But today we pay a lot of attention to human authority. So much so that, you know, they've taken Christ out of Christmas. Now it's called a holiday. And so we forget sometimes. And let's not go to the founding fathers, because the founding fathers, they were not Christian, they were deists. They believed in a power, in a God. And so our responsibility is the same as the apostles, except we are dealing in a whole different context. So that means we have to be informed, just like they were informed. They had been raised in the Jewish faith. They had a belief that God had promised a Messiah. They believed that Jesus was that Messiah. And so they taught it in their own context. Our congregations need to be very, very wise. And you have a wise leader, Rob. Rob is a very good pastor. This is the only church he's ever pastored. Isn't that amazing? It's rare, very rare. And yet, he has really opened you up to the community, to people in this congregation, and the amazing things that this congregation does. It really is very good. But we are living in different times, and the way we do ministry can change. I'll share with you a personal thing, and that is we're members of St. Andrew Presbyterian Church. St. Andrew is an older, you think I'm old, I'll be 89 next month. I'm one of the oldest, but we're an older congregation with very few youth and very little outreach. And so it's important that we examine where we are, who we are, and how we need to tailor our ministry so that we can be like the disciples, obeying God first and not human authority. So this Sunday after Easter is important that we do not just look at next year. What are we going to do for Easter? What are we going to wear? Where are we going to take the kids to hunt for eggs? Our responsibility is to see that we bring and raise our children in the church, that we bring new people to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ, that we realize that we need God in our lives, just as the apostles did. And even though they risked their life, yet, once in a while, there are heroes who call you back to your faith. You think those Muslims that Allah sent to me did not strengthen my faith? They did. It didn't change me to be a Muslim. I respect them. I respect their faith. But it showed me that other people have a conviction that leads them to live a life a certain way. And so it should be for us, that as we and the apostles remember that Christ came, even after Sunday of Easter, we need to have every Sunday as an Easter. For every Sunday is a time when we gather together to recall what Christ did for the world. And that we, I always tell congregations when we do the benediction, the worship does not end here. The worship really begins when you walk out the door. For then is when we show the world who we are. May God bless you. May God bless this congregation. And may we always rejoice in the fact that we are going to obey our God first and not human authority. Amen.
Celebrating our core values, we're going to invite Janie to come forward. No?
The hymn first.
Oh, the hymn first. Okay, then you come forward,
thank you.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
As Tracy said, I am doing today's LSSG on the Habitat for Humanity San Antonio Presbyterian Cluster. Holy Smoke fundraising event. For about sponsors like the Presbyterian Cluster, pay Habitat for Humanity for the cost to construct the house that we sponsor. For about 20 years, the Presbyterian Cluster House has been fully paid by us by the time construction starts. Not every sponsor can say that. You know, we pay the Habitat for Humanity San Antonio for the total cost, and then the homeowners purchase the house from Habitat for Humanity. This year's owners, next slide please, Walter and Claudia Estrada, see the two of them. Center and to the right. They have three children, and they recently moved into their new home. And the young lady standing there is a young volunteer that my sister Martha got to come along with us from her church. Her name is Claudia Carrasco, so 16 years old and wanted to get her hands dirty that day. This family is just representative of the kind of folks that get helped find their first homes. They get all sorts of training from Habitat for Humanity, qualify for the home, and right there they're putting in their sweat equity, and it's pretty great to volunteer and help out. So we are now in the process of our big fundraising event called Holy Smoke. The next one, next slide please, is Cinco de Mayo, easy day to remember. It's next Sunday. Dinner starts at 5:30. There's entertainment at 6:45, but before and during dinner and up to the entertainment, there will be a raffle of some gift baskets that are donated by each church. So there's a chance to win some prizes for a little extra contribution, you know, purchase the tickets. So I am selling. I've been asked to try and sell 10 tickets. I have 9 left. Tirso bought one. Yay, Tirso. Getting them in advance from me is $12, but at the door, you can still get them at $15. And children 12 and under are free. It's a family affair. The entertainment's going to be a musical group this year, I'm told, are very, very good. I really hope that we can get a nice little showing from our church. I'll be selling them next Sunday morning as well, but this event is next Sunday evening, and if we could be in support, because as I said, this is the big fundraising event for the year, but you can give out all through the year. You can make a donation online at the HabitatSA.org, because that's important that it's HabitatSA. And you can make a donation on your anniversary, on a birthday, to remember a loved one. Just to remember when you bought your first house and what it was like. Any contribution, as long as it goes to the Presbyterian Cluster, that will be get the money into the house we are sponsoring. So, I can accept checks for these. Checks made out to the SA Presbyterian Cluster Habitat, Holy Smoke. But cash is always welcome as well. I hope we see a lot of you next Sunday. Oh, our sister, Sharon Guerrero, is going to sponsor our contribution to the potluck dinner. It's always potluck, as those of you know who've been there before. Sharon is going to make a beautiful pasta dish. So hopefully, nothing else will be there to support her as for our contribution. So hope to see you then, and Habitat all the way.
From the many gifts that the Lord has given us, let's present our offering.